Media in Johannesburg, this is the Real Economy Report. To promote renewable energy as a cost-effective technology amid climate change and global warming, the University of South Africa, Exxaro Resources, and the South African National Energy Development Institution launched in November its first institutional anaerobic digester. Simone Lietke reports.
Dubbing it a man-made stomach, Working for Energy General Manager David Mohuma explains that these anaerobic digesters will be used as a source of fuel and that it will also help the environment by minimizing organic waste.
Let me say anaerobic digesters, I want to try to simplify this as much as possible, but I would say it's a man-made stomach, basically where, you know, food is taken in, it decomposes in the absence of oxygen. And then you get byproducts. The byproducts would be, you know, gas, methane gas, carbon dioxide, and some trace gases. But also you get the digestate, which is a very sterile form of fertilizer, wet fertilizer. So this whole process uses water. So I think it's important that we know that water is very important in this particular technology.
Despite it being an age-old technology being used, he further tells us a bit about the rationale surrounding how the idea and the project came to life.
It's an age-old technology, and it has been used extensively in a lot of developing countries, but also in developed countries. If you look at developed countries like Germany, they're actually using, you know, all of the waste, you know, waste food from the kitchens, waste food from the markets, any waste, animal waste, you know, human waste, all of that, you know, can be digested. So for South Africa, I think the problem was that we had very, very cheap electricity for a long time, and that is why we didn't, you know, catch on onto this technology earlier. But also the fact that, you know, the South African programs focus more on electricity-based technologies, so thermal applications for the households, thermal applications for institutions were not taken care of. So this then gives us an opportunity then to deal with, you know, waste management, number one, but also to produce, you know, local biogas, which is much cleaner, which burns much better than LPG, and which basically can be produced, you know, anywhere as long as you've got, you know, the containment, as long as you've got a waste resource and you've got water.
19 more installations are in the pipeline to be installed at a variety of locations, with a particular focus on institutions, including, but not limited to, old age homes, schools and clinics. This focus on institutions, Mohuma explains, is because of a higher ratio of people who can benefit from one such system at an institution.
This is a partnership, and it's part of the research and development that we are doing. Now, one of the prerequisites for installation of these systems is water, is availability of biomass, right? So before we do any installation, we actually do a feasibility study over time to make sure that there is sustainable biomass, there is also sustainable water supply, but also there's a need, because there are instances where you install a system and the demand is so low that you know, you actually produce a lot of methane, which you end up flaring, right? So we are trying to avoid that. So in answering your question with respect to the timelines, it will depend on how suitable we'll find, you know, the balance of the 20 sites, you know, going forward. The installations are going to be done mainly in institutions, and the reason why we've chosen institutions is because when you look at the number of people who benefit out of the system, per system, the ratio is much, much higher with institutions than with individuals. There are systems that can be used for individuals, right, but they are much, much smaller than the one that we have seen here. So for all the 20, we'll be looking at places like this, SARDA, which is taking care of, you know, children with disabilities. We'll be looking at old age homes, we'll be looking at ECDs, early childhood development centers, schools, boarding schools, and clinics, both in rural and in urban settings. So that's the thinking. The system that we have seen here is imported, right? And one of the drives that Sanedi and Unisa are pushing for is localization. So at this point in time, we are not yet at a point where we can produce the systems locally en masse. We will still import this type, but there are other types that can be built, you know, by hand, by brick. Those we have applied in other areas, in rural areas. And then, of course, we have got other companies, local companies, that are producing different designs to the brick ones, to the tube ones. We've got a company based in the Western Cape, which is producing this. So it's not like we don't have these ourselves, we do. But we still want to customize them in such a way that we have got, you know, better reach.
The anaerobic digesters are also able to help to stabilize food security and facilitate sustainable waste management.
Let me say that this project doesn't need fresh water. So you can't use grey water. So if your source of grey water is guaranteed, then you know this project will work for you. So instead of your water going to waste, you basically are going to use the water to, you know, produce the gas, and ultimately what you're going to have is going to be a fertilizer, which is going to help you with, you know, food security and so on and so on. The other problem that this project solves is where you've got raw waste which is not treated. As I said, it's almost like a stomach. Basically it sanitizes, you know, the waste, and at the same time produces byproducts that are useful, you know, to men, which is gas and fertilizer. So instead of having the waste running off into the water system, you basically are capturing all of that, you are processing it, you are sanitizing it, you are sterilizing it. The other benefit is that if you leave waste untreated, unattended, like for instance in landfill sites, I mean, you can still landfill, you know, animal waste. If you leave it like that, the decomposition process is still going to happen. You're still going to have methane released in the atmosphere, right? Which is much, much more a potent gas than carbon dioxide. So it's a lot easier to process your waste and produce, you know, biogas and use it and convert it to carbon dioxide than leave it as methane into the atmosphere. So those are some of the environmental benefits that come with this particular project.
That's Crew Media's Real Economy Report. Join us again next week for more news and insights into South Africa's real economy.